Christo anesti, alethos anesti. Beauty is restored, restored indeed. Christ is risen, risen indeed. However you say it, whether it's in Greek or in Navajo or in English or whatever language, Christ is risen. And we welcome you to this virtual service for Easter celebration with the United Even Apart Church of Santa Fe. Wherever you are, either physically or on your life's journey, you are welcome. And we're very glad you're joining us for this special celebration of God's new life, even in this most challenging of times, especially in this most challenging of times. We're grateful that you're joining us for worship, and we hope that both the music, the scripture, the reflection, the prayers, the art, all of that will feed your soul and make you hungry even more so for God's presence and God's promise of resurrection in your life and in the life of this world. Thank you for joining us this morning. Just a word about the United Church of Santa Fe. We're part of the United Church of Christ, a progressive Protestant tradition, and we seek to welcome all people, regardless of your background, gender, marital status, race, class, all those things that divide the human family. We're very glad you've joined us, and we welcome you on your journey of faith. We also are a church that is very committed to love God, love neighbor, and love creation. And we do that in a whole variety of ways, whether it's making kits, hygiene kits for your Church World Service to distribute in Ukraine, or helping Afghan refugees resettle here in Santa Fe, or being involved in ministries at the border of the United States and Sonora, Mexico, feeding the homeless who are here in Santa Fe, keeping small businesses alive in Santa Fe, all kinds of ways. We are a church that seeks to love our neighbor and love God's creation. You can find more about us at unitedchurchofsantafe.org. And if you'd like to support any of our ministries, both our outreach ministries or our ministries with children or music or all the other things that we offer, we also invite you to go to unitedchurchofsantafe.org and click on the Donate Now button. But most of all, we invite you to open your heart and your whole soul, your whole being, to this service of celebration of new life and of God's promises to us and to this world. Again, we're very glad you've joined us for worship this morning. And now I invite us to begin this time of worship together, as we do every time we gather as a congregation, whether virtually or in person, and that is by taking a moment to breathe in God's good gifts, to breathe in deeply the gift of God's peace that passes all understanding. To breathe in God's gift of hope that overcomes all despair. And to breathe in God's gift of love that even death and hatred and violence could not, will not, and never will destroy. Let us gather to worship God, the Lord and giver of life. Christ is risen. Christo anesti. Alithos anesti, beauty is restored, restored indeed. Christ is risen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
It is our custom here at the United Church to remember the journey that brought us to Easter Sunday, a journey that began on Palm Sunday a week ago, but then took us into the back alleys and back streets of the city of Jerusalem, to a crowd whose first cries had been Hosanna in the highest, to a crowd on Good Friday whose cries were shouts of Crucify. It's a hard journey, but it's the only way to get to new life. And so in the spirit of that, being truthful about our faith and about our lives, I invite us to remember the journey that we've just taken all the way back to Palm Sunday. We remember it in scripture, in song, in pictures. Let us take this journey, remember this journey, once again.
We remember last Sunday. The next day, the great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord."
We remember this past Friday. When Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine was by the cross. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is accomplished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back.
Thank you. Sing praise to God, for God is good. Dios es bueno. Dios es bueno. Give thanks for a new day. Da gracias por la nueva vida. Gracias por la nueva vida. Give thanks for the sunrise and the gift of new light. Gracias por la nueva vida. Give thanks for fresh air and the gift of blue sky. Gracias por la nueva vida. Give thanks for our united, even apart, church community, for friends and family, colleagues and co-workers, and all the ways God loves us. Gracias por la nueva vida. Give thanks for the signs of new life all around us. Gracias por la nueva vida. Aleluya, aleluya, aleluya.
As we prepare to engage God's word for this day of celebration, I invite us to join in a prayer of invocation based on the words of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., who knew about the cost of discipleship and the power of new life. Let us pray. We praise you, O God, that by the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have shown us time and again you are able. Able to deliver us from the power of death, able to make a way out of no way, able to overcome our fears with your love and new life. Give us the courage to entrust our lives to you and the faith to know that you are able. Able to transform desolate valleys into sunlit paths of joy, able to bring new life into the dark caverns of pessimism, able to help us face the uncertainties of the future and turn dark yesterdays into bright tomorrows. May our faith in you be our hope for being better human beings. May the power of your new life be our mandate to make a better world for all your people. Amen. People of God, hear the good news of resurrection power. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us sing our praise to this living God. Pivots of faith. That's been our theme as we've taken this Lenten journey together. Pivot is a word that we've used oftentimes, many times over the last 2 years as a verb, that every time the COVID scene changed or other aspects of life changed, we've had to pivot one way or the other. But this season of Lent, I've invited the congregation to consider the word pivot as a noun, as in pivot joint. The thing, the joint that comes down from a threshold of a door, bottom of a door, into a threshold to enable the door to turn in different directions, the pivot joint. Or the pivot joint that's in our knee that allows us to twist and turn, makes for great basketball playing. The pivot in our neck that allows our head just to turn in different directions. And that in our faith, there are certain things that are pivots, that help us get grounded enough so that no matter how much life swirls around us, we're grounded in God's love, God's prayer, God's faith, God's hope, that enable us to turn as we need, but not lose our balance. So that's what we've explored, the pivot of prayer, the pivot of mystery, the pivot of love. Today, I invite us to consider one more pivot, perhaps the ultimate pivot, and that is the pivot of resurrection, the pivot of new life, which is truly what our lives are grounded in, certainly on Easter Sunday, but the whole of our lives in this journey of faith as well. And to help in that exploration, I invite us to hear the continuation of the resurrection story from the Gospel of Luke. We began it toward the beginning of the service. And now this is after the women have come to the tomb. Well, I'll let Katie Bickley and Eddie Napoli continue the story for us.
The story of this day continues from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24. While the women were perplexed about the emptiness of the tomb, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again."
Then the women remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. Word of God, word of life.
Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to Christ's name. Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to Christ's name.
Please join me in a time of prayer. God of ceaseless new beginnings, open us again this day to your ancient word that it might offer us new life. Let that word, the story that we may have heard so many times, go deep enough into our lives, our hearts, our souls, and minds, that it might offer us new life. Transform our lives. Resurrect our lives. And we pray this not only for ourselves, but for the sake of this world that you so love. We ask in your name. Amen. In the Christian church, we use a whole variety of symbols for Easter. It is one of the most symbolic days, seasons of the whole year. I'm surrounded today by those symbols. The Easter lilies that are like wonderful white trumpets that proclaim, Christ is risen, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The multitude of candles that are on the table, proclaiming the light that shines in the shadows and the shadows have never overcome it. The golden cross with the emanating rays of light behind me. We use things like Easter eggs that hold new life in what almost feels like an empty tomb. We use butterflies, those wonderful creatures that start out as caterpillars crawling along, but then go through this complete metamorphosis, complete transformation to become wonderful butterflies. Today I'd like to add one more symbol for Easter and for resurrection, and that's a basketball. Why? Well, because in this story that we just heard, that Eddie and Katie read so wonderfully, the women went to the tomb that morning expecting to find a dead body. But instead, they found an empty tomb and then angels. And then when they ran back and told the men, the disciples didn't believe them, believing it to be an idle tale, and in some versions of Luke's gospel, there's a parenthesis, told by foolish women. But the fact of the matter is that at least at the very beginning, neither the women nor the male disciples could possibly believe this good news of resurrection. Jesus had told them that in 3 days he would be raised from the dead. But that morning, the women, following the custom, had gone to the tomb to anoint the body. And the men, after the women came back from the tomb, told of this wonderful vision of angels and being reminded about what he had told them about his resurrection and all of that, they couldn't believe them. Until at least Peter ran to the tomb to see for himself. And all throughout the rest of the Gospels, and also into the book of Acts, and into the rest, all of Scripture, all of Christian Scripture, trying to believe in the resurrection, trying to live into the resurrection, was simply hard work. And my friends, it still is. And to ground our lives, center our lives in the pivot of resurrection, that doesn't come naturally for us. It takes practice. Practice. You know, there's the old joke about how do you get to Carnegie Hall? practice, practice, practice. Whether you're a singer or an instrumentalist, doing scales and practicing your music on a daily basis is how you finally put all the music together to be able to play or to sing and to make beauty. If you're a basketball player or an aspiring basketball player, you've got to be able to practice as well. You've got to practice your pivots. You've got to practice your passes. You've got to practice your jump shots. You've got to practice your free throws. You've got to practice how to dribble. Practice, practice, practice. Whether you're playing basketball or tennis or playing an instrument or using your voice as an instrument or trying to live into new life. Practice, practice, practice. Because, my friends, in this old world, resurrection doesn't come easily, and especially not in our time. When the papers and news and radio and Twitter and everything else are all so filled with dead ends and fear and violence, resurrection seems like a pipe dream. And that was true for the disciples and those women as well. Even the ones who'd been to the empty tomb, even the ones who saw the resurrected Christ later that day or in the days to come. Belief in God's possibility of new life, living, grounding one's life in the pivot of resurrection, living a life that is grounded in God's presence and promise of new life for ourselves and for our loved ones, for our churches, for this whole world. That is hard work, and it takes practice. Practice. Barbara Kingsolver, the wonderful author, wrote in her book of essays, High Tide in Tucson, these words. In my own worst seasons, I've come back from the colorless world of despair, by forcing myself to look hard for a long time at a single glorious thing. A flame of red geranium outside my bedroom window. And then another, my daughter in a yellow dress. And another, the perfect outline of a full dark sphere where the crescent moon, behind the crescent moon. Doing all this day by day until I learned to be in love with my life again. Like someone recovering, retraining new parts of my brain to grasp lost skills, I have taught myself joy over and over again. Day by day, until I learned to be in love with my life again. That's practicing resurrection. And we do it in a whole variety of ways in the Christian church. We certainly do it by coming together on Easter Sunday filled with Easter lilies and hallelujah choruses and people and color and life. And we do it all the other 364 days of the year as well, through prayer, through thanksgiving, through coming together week by week, whether on a Friday evening or a Saturday noon or a Sunday morning, to be with other people who are also practicing resurrection. And this year, my friends, there is an example of people who have no reason whatsoever to believe in the possibility of new life, who are continuing to teach us about practicing resurrection. In the Ukrainian Christian Orthodox tradition, there is a tradition of what are called Pesenki Easter eggs. They look like this, this very full basket of Easter eggs. And they're intricately designed and colored, each one slightly different from the other, but also following centuries-old patterns and pictures. The symbolism of the different eggs have different meaning, but they all point to new life. The tradition of the Pysanky Easter eggs actually predates Christianity, which didn't come to the Ukrainian people until the 900s, when the then leader of the people sent his emissaries all over the world to find what he called, what he wanted was the most beautiful religious tradition. And they came back with stories and images of the Greek Orthodox tradition, filled with color and mystery. And that's what he adopted then as the religion, at least the Christian religion, for his people. But the tradition of the Pysanky Easter eggs predates all of that. They were decorating eggs even before. And it was according to a Ukrainian legend that there was a devilish ogre who lived in a cave in this world, who, if ever let out, would fill the world with evil and violence. And the Easter and the eggs became a part of a chain that kept the ogre with all of its evil in place. And so every time an egg was painted, it was a symbol of goodness overcoming evil, life overcoming death, peace overcoming violence. When Ukraine became an overall Christian country, then that tradition of these Easter eggs was adopted into the Christian faith. And so every year for hundreds of years, Ukrainian people have been making these Ukrainian Easter eggs with all of their intricate designs. It takes a long time, I've been told, to learn how to decorate this particular style of Ukrainian Easter egg, because it's done with a hot wax system and a very narrow stylus and all kinds of artistic techniques I don't understand, and therefore I'm not going to try to explain. But suffice it to say, it takes practice, practice, practice to develop even just one of these eggs. And this year, that tradition is continuing. It is continuing among the refugees who have fled Ukraine and are now living in places like Poland or Holland or other countries throughout Europe. It is a tradition that has continued also, even more so, among Ukrainian American Christians living in places like Chicago. In fact, there's a whole group of Ukrainian American women in Chicago this season of Lent, leading into Easter, for the Orthodox Church is next Sunday, not today. But they've banded together to teach one another and others the intricate art of decorating Pysanky eggs. And for them, it is a form of prayer, as it always has been, that each stroke reminds them that somehow they are affirming life over death, that they are chaining that evil and violence in this world. One of the women who organized the Chicago group, Anna Chaikula, said, "Make the change stronger. Know that you are making a difference. Because a Pysanka is a hope. It is a prayer. It is a wish. Decorating a Pysanky egg is like writing a prayer or a message, a prayer of hope and a message of life." How do we get to new life? Practice, practice, practice. How do you learn how to decorate a Ukrainian Easter egg, especially this year? Practice, practice, practice. How do we affirm that our lives are grounded in the pivot of God's resurrection? Practice, practice, practice. Christ is risen. Beauty is restored. Christo Anesti. Christ is risen indeed. And so are we. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Let us be together in a time of prayer. Let us pray. God of ceaseless new beginnings, God of every sunrise, in the resurrection you did the completely unexpected deed. You faced down death and raised Jesus Christ to life. You transformed frightened disciples and ordinary women into your witnesses for new life and hope in this world. On this Easter, we pray that you would transform our lives, that we might transform this world. Open our eyes to see your new light and life all around us. Give us the courage and hope to trust your resurrection power in our lives. And God of this whole world, hear our prayers for this world. For all who suffer and all who seek to help, for an end to this scourge of illness and hatred, and for a renewed commitment to give our lives for the sake of your people and all creation. Hear the prayers that we offer from the silence of our hearts. God of new life, hear all of our prayers, spoken and unspoken. We pray all this in the name of the risen Christ, your word of love made flesh in our world, your sign of hope and new life, the one who taught us to pray with boldness, courage, and trust, saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us sing our praise to the living God. It is our custom here with the United Even Apart Church of Santa Fe that every Easter we read the names of persons from the congregation who have died in this past year, members and friends. I will read that list of names, and that is followed by a time of silence, and I invite you also to lift up in your own prayers the names of persons you would want remembered. Following that, I offer the benediction. And then we join together, as also the custom of the United Church, in singing the Hallelujah Chorus. And so now, my friends, let us remember this day. Harry Turner, Halenti Homans, Bumblebee Bob Weil, Don Strell, Liliana Ferrari, Mills Bickley, Tim Timmerman, Bill Carson, Olivia Vinone Dodson, Elizabeth Ann Karsner, and we remember too all who have died from COVID and all who have died in wars. You're invited to offer and lift up the names you have in your heart as well. And now, my beloved friends, I bid you to go out into and be in this world in peace. Have courage, hold on to what is good, return no one evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the suffering, honor all persons, honor all creation, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the love of God, the light of Christ, and the power and communion of that Spirit be with us all. Go in peace. Christ is risen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.